أما قد فصل الله بكل أيما جهل بجهل أنزل الرحمن فيه أشرف الذكر وهل يسبحه شهر وفيه ليلة القدر فكم من خابر صحى بما فيها من الأجر قوينا عن ثقات أنها تقلام في الوتر فطوبى لمن يقلوبها في هذه العشر ففيها تنزل الأملاك بالأنوار والبر وقد قالا سلام هي حتى مطلع الفجر ألا فالداخر ها إنها من أنفس الدخر فكم من معتق فيها من
What are some of the neglected sunan in Ramadan? There's many sunan that come to mind as it pertains to Ramadan. Among them, for example, is using the miswak. Amr ibn Rabi'a said, I couldn't count how many times I saw the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam using the miswak while he was fasting, suppressing one's anger, being calm, not arguing, not using vile language, not raising one's voice in arguments. That's a sunnah even when the other person is wrong. If someone's faced by a hostile individual in Ramadan while he's fasting, he should follow the sunnah and tell him that he is fasting. إِذَا كَانَ يَوْمُ صَوْمِ أَحَدِكُمْ فَلَا يَرْفُثْ وَلَا يَصْخَبْ فَإِنْ سَابَّهُ أَحَدٌ أَوْ قَاتَلَهُ فَلْيَقُلْ إِنِّي امْرُؤٌ صَائِمٌ Suhoor is also sunnah. Everyone knows about that one. Musad Ahmad, فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ وَمَلَائِكَتَهُ يُصَلُّونَ عَلَى الْمُتَسَحِّرِينَ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the angels send their blessings upon those who do suhoor. Delaying the suhoor is another sunnah. Suhoor should be close to fajr. Zayd ibn Thabit said, radiallahu anh, we used to have suhoor with the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then he would go and perform his salah. Anas radiallahu anh asked him, what was the time between the suhoor and the salah? He said, approximately the time it takes to recite 50 ayat. So that would be about 15 minutes or so. Hastening the fast is also a sunnah. Because of the hadith in Bukhari and Muslim, people will remain on goodness as long as they hasten the breaking of the fast. Providing fasting people with something to break their fast on is an important sunnah. It's forgiveness of the sins, and it saves one from Jahannam wal-iyadu billah. And the person will attain a reward equal to the one who was fasting without his reward being diminished in any way. Being generous in Ramadan. That's a sunnah of Ramadan. It's sunnah outside of Ramadan, but it's also a sunnah in Ramadan. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was always generous, but more so in Ramadan. Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma said he was more generous than the fast wind. He resembled his generosity to the fast wind because the wind carries everything within it. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was most generous, not just with wealth, but everything else. Helping other people, teaching, da'wah, advice. Comparing the generosity of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to the wind also indicates how fast his generosity was. The wind carries within it mercy and goodness. And it encompasses all creation. And the generosity of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam encompassed all. Befriending the Quran is always essential all throughout the year. But more so in Ramadan where the reward is multiplied by many more folds. Night Qiyam is also a sunnah. Everyone knows about that sunnah, but waking up the spouses in particular and the relatives is a sunnah in itself. In the hadith, وَأَيْقَظَ أَهْلَهُ Also, it's good for one to make dua after completing the entire Quran. This is not specific for Ramadan, but Ramadan is a time where many recite and complete the Quran more often. It was narrated that Anas ibn Malik, radiallahu anhu, used to gather his family and children and make dua when he finished the recitation of the Quran. And some tabi'een followed along with that, as in the several narrations by Mujahid rahimahullah ta'ala. In salah, that's outside of salah. In salah, there's no dua of completing the Quran. There's no authentic hadith, nor any narration by any of the sahaba that they did dua of finishing the Quran in salah, whether it's before ruku' or after, or whether it's by an imam in his congregation, or whether it's done individually. There's nothing authentic on that. In salah. There's many more, and you can see our series, The Gems of Ramadan, where we mentioned other sunan that pertain to Ramadan. There is, however, a sunnah that needs to be emphasized, and that's truly an abandoned sunnah. It's the sunnah of cursing and making dua on the kuffar in Ramadan. Muwatta Imam Malik al-A'raj said, مَا أَدْرَكْتُ النَّاسَ إِلَّا وَهُمْ يَلْعَنُونَ الْكَفَرَةَ فِي رَمَضَانِ ما أدركت الناس إلا وهم يلعنون الكفرة في رمضان. I found the people cursing the kuffar during Ramadan. Al-A'raj found the Sahaba and the elders of the Tabi'in invoking the curse of Allah and making dua on the kuffar in their dua of qunut. Ibn Abd al-Barr said, it's due to their anger for the transgression of the kuffar against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he said it doesn't matter even if they're the people of the dhimma. In a portion of a longer hadith, Ibn Khuzaymah mentions that kana an-nasu, Ibn Khuzaymah related that kana an-nasu yaqumuna awwalahu wa kanu yal'anuna al-kafarata fi an-nisfi. اللهم قاتل الكفرة الذين يصدون عن سبيلك ويكذبون رسلك ولا يؤمنون بوعدك وخالف بين كلمتهم وألق في قلوبهم الرعب وألق عليهم رجسك وعذابك إلى الحق. He mentioned that the believers during time of Umar ibn al-Khattab رضي الله عنه would invoke the curse of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the kuffar starting from the middle of Ramadan. In Al-Istidhkar, Ibn Abd al-Barr stated that Imam Malik was asked, when did they curse the kuffar in Ramadan? Was it in the beginning or its end? He said, from the middle of Ramadan until the end of Ramadan. كانوا يلعنون الكفرة في رمضان في النصف منه حتى ينسلخ رمضان. العلامة الإمام الحافظ أبو الوليد الباجي said, الأندلسي القرطبي, he said they used to do that دعاء in the قنوت of Ramadan in Witr. The benefits of that are many. It's following the footsteps of the Salaf, the Sahaba and the Tabi'in who did it. It's دعاء on the Kuffar to stop their mischief and evil. It's affirming and reviving the aqidah of wala and bara in Ramadan, especially now when there's a war on that principle and when it's neglected by many or most, illa man rahim Allah. The inseparability between Ramadan and wala and bara becomes more evident in the great battles and victories that took place in Ramadan. The battle of wala and bara that took place in Ramadan, it was referred to by Allam al-Ghuyub as Yawm al-Furqan. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Yawm al-Furqani, Yawm al-Taqal Jam'an. Allah called it Yawm al-Furqan, the day the truth was separated from evil. Separation of truth from evil is wala and bara. The conquest of Mecca took place in Ramadan. So did the battle of Al-Qadisiyah. The conquest of Al-Andalus under the leadership of Tariq ibn Ziyad, 92 years after the Hijrah, along with Ain Jalut and Hittin and many other battles, they all took place in Ramadan. Just as it's common to focus on the spiritual, imanic ibadat in Ramadan, like Siyam, Qiyam, Salah, Tasbih, Adhkar, recitation of the Quran and the Sunnah that we mentioned, invoking the curse of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the kuffar, in dua on them, and wala and bara must be emphasized just as much, if not more, because it's strongly intertwined with this blessed month, and it's greatly neglected and abandoned. And we learned that it's revived in this month in the hadi of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam with his battles and with the statements that we mentioned of the Salaf.